Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, let me thank IDSA for giving me this opportunity for sharing this stage with such eminent speakers from across the globe. I truly feel honored. In the next 15 to 20 minutes or so, I'm going to speak on the subject of non-state actors in cyberspace, especially in context with India. Now, on the 2nd of January this year, a group of heavily armed militants attacked the Pathankot Air Force Base. After about 48 hours of battle and some casualties to one side, all six of these militants, terrorists, were destroyed, neutralized. In all probability, if we believe the media reports, there were a group of Fidayeen who infiltrated from across the international border and executed the act. Mobile intercept showed that all six of them were in touch with their handlers across the international border. Now, we in India have been a little fortunate that the terrorists coming from across the border have not adopted to the devastating technologies that we see being used in the other parts of the world. Now, consider this. While the gun battle was on at the Pathankot Air Base, on the early hours of 3rd January, the northern Indian electricity grid trips, plunging the state of JNK and Punjab into darkness. Early morning on the same day, the BTSs in and around Pathankot start misrouting calls, and most mobile calls virtually stop materializing. Obviously, the internet on these phones also does not work. By 7 in the morning, there are enough posts on Twitter and Facebook which show burning aircrafts and dead soldiers at the Pathankot airfield. The posts go viral within minutes. Investigations on a later date would reveal that these cyber attacks were carried out by the same handlers who had infiltrated these terrorists across from the international border. Obviously, Pakistan government denies having any hand in such activities. Like the physical attack, perhaps, some of the non-state actors based in Pakistan, who, acting on behalf of Pakistan, carried out these cyber attacks. By painting this picture, what I'm trying to bring out is that now non-state actors operating in the virtual world today can be as dangerous a threat to a nation as the non-state actors operating in the real world. In the Arthashastra, Chanakya has written that a state could be at risk from four types of threats, that is internal, external, externally aided internal, and internally aided external. While Chanakya wrote this in 350 BC, when no cyberspace existed, yet despite a passage of over 200 years, his words still hold good and apply to the cyberspace, a phenomena which is not even 35 years old. What Chanakya referred to as externally aided internal and internally aided external threats are the threats emanating from non-state actors. There are no universal accepted definition of who non-state actor is. The Geneva Center for Democratic Control of Armed Forces defines the non-state actors as any organized group with a basic structure of command operating outside state control that uses force to achieve its political or allegedly political objectives. While the above definition of a non-state actor is for the real world, who could be a non-state actor in the virtual world? And how would they be different from a non-state actor operating in the real world? Cyberspace is an arena where non-state actors of various kinds thrive. Once again, there are no universal classification for these players. I have identified two distinct categories of group whom I can call non-state actors. The first type of non-state actors are the organizations that have created the cyberspace. Critical infrastructure of most nations is created by the government of the nation and is owned by the government. Cyber infrastructure, on the other hand, has been created and is largely owned by private business houses and organizations. Thus, the first category of non-state actors in the cyberspace are these good guys who have created the cyberspace. They are also amongst the most targeted non-state people in the cyberspace. However, they are not the focus of my attention today. The second category of non-state actors in the cyberspace are the bad guys who pose a threat to the cyberspace. I further categorize these non-state actors into two distinct subcategories. The first category is of those non-state actors who form part of radical organizations such as the ISIS or Al-Qaeda. They are also referred to as cyber terrorists. These are the people who indulge in the use of internet and networks against critical national infrastructure in order to hit or intimidate a society and its people, causing casualties or injuries for ideological, political or religious reasons. Though not very many examples of major cyber attacks by such non-state actors can be cited, however, that does not imply that they are not capable of it. These organizations are exploiting the cyberspace in many other manners: recruitment, generation of fund, projection of power, and propaganda using the social media are some of the activities being undertaken by cyber terrorists. I'm sure each one of us present here is aware of the way IS is targeting the US government website. As per of some news reports which appeared in the US media and as late as December 15, the IS group is looking to expand its online capabilities in order to carry out cyber attacks against US targets, including the federal government and the airplanes. Now, despite being a major threat in the cyberspace, cyber terrorists are also not the focus of my attention as far as India is concerned. What I am going to focus on is the second important subcategory of non-state actors in the cyberspace, whom I call cyber militia. And as per my analysis, cyber militia pose a bigger threat to India than a cyber terrorist. So who's a cyber militia? I define cyber militia as a group of volunteers who are willing and able to use cyber attacks or other forms of disruptive cyber actions on behalf of a nation state in order to achieve a political goal. In the words of Chanakya, they fall into the group of externally aided cyber threat. Cyber militia are men not in uniform but motivated enough to be employed in covert government orchestrated campaigns with the purpose to further the strategic, political or military objectives of the government. It is said that China has established PLA Unit 61398, staffed by thousands of computer professionals as cyber troops, acting on direct control of the PLA. Unit 61398 is supposed to be responsible for all major cyber attacks, if the Western reports are to be believed. China, on the other hand, completely denies even very existence of any such unit, leave alone the attacks carried out by it. If a country like China can rely on non-state actors in the form of Unit 61398, it is a matter of time that even Pakistan would create such capabilities and use them against India in line with our policy of state-sponsored terrorism, if it is not already doing so. Pakistan especially is influenced by two of our policies. First, being disruption of opposing conventional operations while maintaining credible nuclear threat, and the second, peacetime use of disruptive provocation in the form of terrorism. Disruptive provocation using the cyberspace will be an essential ingredient of our overall plan. Non-state actors will play a key role during the peacetime in implementation of such a policy. Now, when a nation state covertly adopts the policy to use non-state actors to sponsor terror through the cyberspace, it indeed would lead to serious security concerns for a government. But then the question arises, why not use just the state machinery? Why use non-state actors at all? Employing cyber militia in place of regular cyber organizations will have tremendous advantages. Some of them could be: cyberspace no boundaries, and hence in cyberspace a non-state actor is a non-territorial player. Thus, they need not be based in the same country which is sponsoring them. The attack can be carried out with the same precision and impact with the attacker based in a third country or perhaps from even Indian soil. This makes the task of attacking nation easier, as attribution becomes even more difficult in such cases. To raise a well-organized cyber wing as part of the government or defense forces would cost a lot of money. By recruiting suitably motivated and technically competent non-state actors, the same task can be achieved at little or no cost. Lack of any hard evidence which can establish attribution will protect the attacker of any political ramification. Thus, the threat of counter-strike is virtually negligible. Now, in 2007, while all evidence showed that the distributed denial service of attack on Estonia originated from Russia, Estonia or NATO could not retaliate due to lack of attribution. Russia completely denied of any involvement. The execution may have been carried out by a patriotic cyber militia on behest of the Russian government. Even if an indisputable link is established between a non-state actor and the nation state, since no laws of war apply to the non-state actors, nothing much can be done to the cyber militia. So what threat does India face from these non-state actors? I'm sure we all have analyzed the Stuxnet attack and the crisis it created in the Iranian nuclear program in 2010. But many of us may not be aware that Stuxnet was detected in Indian hardware too. Stuxnet were designed to attack systems using Windows operating system, Siemens PCS7, WinCC, Step 7 industrial control application that run on Windows and one or more Siemens S7 PLC. In other words, Stuxnet were designed to target computers specifically associated with SCADA. Based on this study of spread of Stuxnet conducted by Symantec, the most affected countries in the early days of infection were Iran, Indonesia, and India. As per their report, 8.31% computers in India were found infected with Stuxnet. How did this worm manage to get into this many high number of computers in India? Did it cause any damage? Obviously, no nation state was involved in perpetrating this attack of Stuxnet against India. The sophistication with which the worm's code was written and lethality with which it carried out the task indicates that it was not the handiwork of some novice hacker. As no money or information was stolen by the exploits of the worm, it is unlikely that some cyber criminal created and planted it. The precision with which Stuxnet attacked SCADA systems indicate that it took a lot of planning and effort to implement this attack. Such a task would have been either done by a nation state or non-state actors acting on behalf of the nation state. The same people who perpetrated the worm attack in Iran also perhaps infected Indian systems. While the damage caused by this Stuxnet in Iran is very clearly documented, what damage did it cause in India is not really known. Though some reports in media indicate that INSAT-4B, a communication satellite launched by India in 2007 and which effectively went dead in 2010, was due to Stuxnet. The same was denied by ISRO, of course, and has not been confirmed by Siemens. Whether the satellite went dead because of Stuxnet or not, the mere fact that such a deadly computer worm was able to penetrate unnoticed into the control systems of a satellite network is a cause of worry. So coming to the threats, the most important threat is the sabotage of the critical infrastructure. Sabotage is an inherent part of cyber warfare. Malicious software and cyber attacks are ideal instruments of sabotage. This is specially applicable for sectors such as telecom, banking, power sector, which are providing public services. As systems become more complex, the knowledge required to attack them also becomes complex. Unless the attacker is backed up by the full financial and knowledge support, sabotaging critical industrial control systems will be a difficult task. While nation state may undertake cyber attacks on the critical infrastructure as part of its strategic offensive cyber policy during war, in peace, non-state actors are the most suited cyber adversaries who can achieve such a task with ease, as they will have all necessary backing of the state. India is in the process of moving from being a partially networked state towards being a networked country. The Digital India program, riding on the massive telecom network of the country, is making inroads to the rural India. We are in the process of creating 100 smart cities. There are a large number of many other programs which the government has already rolled out or they are on the anvil. With the state of automation and networking improving, India's critical infrastructure becomes vulnerable to cyber attacks. Cyber non-state actors during peace, therefore, will be the adversaries which we need to guard against. Another activity which a non-state actor can undertake effectively through the cyberspace against India is subversion. When I say subversion, I mean both subversion of human resource as well as system subversion. Let us first see what human subversion is all about. Many a times, many more can be achieved by an adversary by internal subversion than going to war. As per Thomas Reed, the famous British scholar and writer, information technology has enabled proliferation of subversive causes and ideas. Because of the cyberspace, subversion has become more cause-driven. It is seeing higher levels of membership mobility and ideas. Because of the cyberspace, subversion has become more cause-driven. It is seeing higher levels of membership mobility and now is characterized by lower levels of organization control. One common tool of all subversion activity is media, may it be print, visual, or online media. The kind of influence social media has on the society has gotten in government thinking about the impact it can have on the internal security. Today, politicians, senior government officials can all be seen citing their concern on this issue. whether it is the honey trapping of defense personnel by PAC-based ISI agents or the ISIS operators in India, subversion seems a high agenda on the activities of our neighboring nations. System subversion is a covert and methodical undermining of internal and external controls of a lifetime system over its lifetime. Now, system subversion is a very complex process, and it requires a lot of planning to implement such a thing. So, the viewfinder here depicts a typical wireless covert channel attack over its lifetime. Now, with virtually 100% of our hardware coming from outside, which is used in a critical infrastructure, system subversion is again a very high probability threat that India faces. Espionage. From nation state to novice hackers, everyone seems to be stealing information using the cyberspace. While espionage was always part of any warfare and military campaign, private lives of citizens was spared of it. Today, that is not the case. What we see now on the viewfoil is a case of as recent as 2nd of February 2016, where military training of the Indian Army were being tracked and emailed to Pakistan handlers by postal department person. Though ISI is blamed for it by the Indian media for masterminding this, it appears that this could have been the handiwork of non-state actors who perhaps were acting on behalf of the ISI. So, what could be the counter to the threat of non-state actors? What I would like to summarize the entire thing is that the non-state actor, the problem of non-state actors has two elements. One is the threat itself, and two is the non-state actor himself. When the threat can be neutralized by like the any other threat from in the cyberspace is by creating a secure cyber ecosystem, to neutralize the threat of the non-state actor is a difficult task. In conclusion, I would like to say that being a high-tech country in a volatile environment, India faces a difficult task developing nations. A large part of our nation is coping with problems of terrorism and left-wing extremism. If these radical elements take the cyber route to spread terror, they could cause devastating damage to the country, which could impact our national security. It is time that we in India take a serious view of this and address the issue of cyber conflict originated by non-state actors. Thank you.